please join me now in the minutes of prayer and illumination of times in your Lord. Shall we pray? Lord, open our hearts and minds, and the power of your Holy Spirit, and that as the scriptures are read and your words are lighted, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Scripture reading this morning is taken from the 6th chapter of Gospel of Matthew, verses 25 through 34. This scripture is found on page 840 of your pew Bible. Listen to the word from the Holy Scripture. Therefore I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink, nor about your body, what you shall put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add one cubit to this span of life? And what are you anxious about? Why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. But I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed by one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown in the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O men of little faith? Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat, what shall we drink, and what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things shall be yours as well. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious about itself. Let the day's own trouble be sufficient for the day. We now, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We will now ask the children to come forward, and we'll all sing the first verse of Jesus loves me. Do we have any children? Oh, sorry, children.
Unless you want to stay up here. No. The children are all tired. Yes, almost as tired as the 25 adults at home. Passage that Kathy read to us this morning, of where Jesus is basically saying to us, you know, don't worry. You know, God is going to take care of you. You don't have to be concerned or anxious about tomorrow. The story that I want to tell this morning is one that I know I told here a few years back. Some of you may remember it. You may not. It's one of my favorite stories, but I hope you appreciate it this morning. And the theme really is, don't worry, be happy. Shall we pray? Gracious God, may the words of my lips and the meditations of all our hearts and minds be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Once upon a time, in a land far away, there was a kingdom, a most prosperous kingdom, and the king of that realm was known as King Jonathan. King Jonathan lived in a most fortunate time, for he had inherited a kingdom from his father that was living through the most prosperous of all times. For there were no enemies. All of the neighbors to this particular kingdom were friends of the kingdom. They were offered no threat at all to King Jonathan's kingdom. The coffers, the treasury, the king's treasury was filled to overflowing with all types of riches. It had been a very prosperous several decades in terms of crops being abundant in the fields, and the people were all well fed, and everything was going very splendidly in King Jonathan's kingdom. But King Jonathan had a problem. He was worried about tomorrow. For today, his army was strong, and it had no enemies around the borders. But what if tomorrow an unknown enemy raised a strong army and attacked his kingdom? And King Jonathan constantly worried about that. And the crops, yes, the crops were abundant right now, but what if next year and the following year they suffered through a drought and the crops did not harvest in 2 years in a row and all the people began to go hungry and began to grumble about the king? What then? And King Jonathan, he would have confided in his close advisors about these worries that he had, but he was worried about them. For what if they would rally against him and throw a coup to overthrow him in the kingdom, even though they had been his father's trusted advisors and now had been his trusted advisors for years? Yet King Jonathan worried. And one day, as he was worrying about what's going to happen to his kingdom, he looked out the palace windows and he noticed all the people out in the courtyard laughing and singing and dancing and gathering around the well and exchanging stories and seeming to enjoy life. And King Jonathan said, well, if all the people of my realm are so happy, why am I not happy? What is going on? Why can't I be happy? Why do I always have to worry about all these things that are going to be happening in the future, or that may happen in the future? So King Jonathan hit him on a plan, and he contacted the royal seamstress, and he had her prepare for him an outfit of rags that were torn and dirty, and had them delivered to his room. And King Jonathan carefully took off his crown, and he put on those light rags, and he went over to the fireplace, and he got some soot, and he smeared it on his face and on his arms. He messed up his hair, and he put up a hood over his head, and he looked in the mirror, and he saw what looked like a poor beggar looking back at him. And so King Jonathan snuck out of the castle, and he began to walk among the streets of the people, just as a beggar, and no one recognized King Jonathan as he walked among them. And as King Jonathan walked among the streets, he noticed that the people were seemingly very happy. They were talking and laughing with each other and telling stories about life. They were singing songs with each other. There were people in the streets playing instruments, and people were just spontaneously begin to dance. And King Jonathan began to wonder, well, why aren't these people worried about tomorrow? Because today's good, yes, but what about tomorrow? And as King Jonathan puzzled over this, he continued to wander around the streets of the city. Until that evening, he came to the edge of the city and he finally spotted a very poor, run-down cottage. A one-room cabin, if you will. It looked to be well-kept, but obviously it was in need of some repair. Obviously, whoever lived there didn't have much at all. And as King Jonathan came up close to this cottage, he heard a very happy whistle coming from inside the cottage. And someone was whistling a very merry and a very happy tune. King Jonathan went up to the window and he saw a man dressed much as he was in almost rags there at his table preparing a meal for himself. And for that meal, all he had was a small loaf of bread. And it looked like just a cup of water that he was preparing to eat. King Jonathan said, ah, here's a man that could tell me something about life. And he went and he knocked on the door. And the man opened the door. And King Jonathan said, I am but a poor beggar, and I'm hungry, and I was wondering if you might have some food that you could share. And the man perked up immediately, and he said, why, yes, friend, come on in. My name is Joseph, but my friends call me Joey, so please call me Joey. I'm about to sit down to a feast at my table, and you're welcome here anytime to my table. And so Jonathan said, well, you can call me Johnny. And so Johnny and Joey sat down at the table, and Joey had a small loaf of bread, and he took out a knife, and he cut it in half, and he said a blessing to God for all the goodness of this day, and he gave half the loaf to King Jonathan, Johnny. And he got a small cup of water, and he put it there, and he said, my friend, we're going to feast on this loaf of bread this evening. And Joey started telling King Jonathan stories about his life and laughing and going on. And he said, I am but a poor cobbler. I repair shoes. I don't have the materials to make shoes. But he said, I repair people's shoes that are in disrepair. And today I repaired two pairs of shoes and I had enough to buy this fine loaf of bread for my meal. And King Jonathan immediately said, this loaf of bread is the only food you have in the house. And Joey said, yes, but it's plenty for us to share this meal together. King Jonathan said, but wait, what about tomorrow? If you eat all of this bread, or we eat all this bread tonight, you might not have any bread to eat tomorrow. And Joey looked at King Jonathan, and he looked at him very closely, and he could see the worry wrinkles in his brow and in along the sides of his eyes. And he could see a man worried an awful lot. And Joey looked at King Jonathan and he said, day by day, God is good. It is well. It is well with my soul. King Jonathan was still completely confused. He thanked Joey for the meal. He left, walked back to the palace, and he said, well, Joey had some food to eat today. What happens if he has no shoes to repair tomorrow? So the king sent out an edict and had it placed all around the kingdom. And when Joey went to his little shop the next day, he saw the king's edict on the door of his shop. It says, no one is allowed any longer in this kingdom to have their shoes repaired. When your shoes are in disrepair, you need to get a new pair of shoes. And Joey said, well, I guess I will no longer repair shoes. And he looked around and he noticed an old woman at the well that had drawn a big pail of water and she was struggling to carry it back to her home. So he ran over and he said, ma'am, can I help you carry that back to your home? And so he carried the bucket of water for the woman back to her home. And when he got there, she turned and thanked him, and she pressed a small coin into his hand. And he said, thank you for helping me this day. And so Job, the light came on, and he said, well, go back to the well. And every time a person was struggling with carrying water, Job offered to help them. And most of the people that he walked to their homes and carried water for them just turned and thanked him profusely. But a few of those people would put a coin into his hand. And at the end of the day, Job had enough coins in his hand to not only buy a loaf of bread, but to buy a skin of wine to go along with it. And so he went whistling back to his cottage. The king then, dressed in his pauper's attire once again, returned to the cottage, and he was surprised to hear the whistling coming from the cottage again that evening. And he knocked on the door of Joey's cottage again. Joey threw open the door and he said, oh, Johnny, my friend, come in. I've got to tell you about what a wonderful day that it was. And Johnny heard the story from Joey, relating how he could no longer cobble shoes and repair shoes, but he had found a new profession in carrying water, and that people were so grateful that they gave him enough money that he could have this fine feast of bread and wine for this evening that he was very welcome to share with his new friend, John. So Johnny and Joey ate the food, and Joey told stories of carrying the water that day and of the funny things that happened during the day, and he laughed and laughed, and Johnny couldn't help but laugh along with him at a few of the stories that he told. But after he left the house, King Jonathan thought, well, I've got to think this through a little closer. That didn't really do anything. He was even better off than he was yesterday, so I better come up with a different plan. And so the next morning, Joey returned to the well, and there posted by the well was a new edict from the king. From this day forward, everyone must carry their own water from the well. No one is allowed to carry someone else's water. Joey looked at the edict and thought, wow, we can't even carry water this day. And he looked around and he saw the woodcutter starting to head out to the woods to cut wood. And he went over to one of them and he said, good sir, could you use any help this day? The woodcutter turned and said, well, yes, I could use an extra hand today. Come with me. So Joey went out with the woodcutters into the woods and they cut down trees. And Joey spent a lot of time chopping up the wood and carrying it back into town so that the woodcutters would be able to sell the wood to the people who needed it. And at the end of the day, that woodcutter turned and handed Joey his wage for the day. And Joey looked at it and said, oh my, I never expected this. And so he began to whistle, and on his way home, he brought a loaf of bread, he bought a skin of wine, and he bought a big piece of cheese to go along with it. The king returned to Joey's cottage, knocked on his door, went in, and Joey said, Johnny, I have a real feast for today. And Joey told Johnny about the day, what a fun day it was, how he enjoyed being with the woodcutters, and what a great group of people they were, and that he was going to go back with the woodcutters again tomorrow, and this looked like what he was going to be doing from now on. They enjoyed the great feast of wine and bread and cheese, and as King Jonathan left, he just shook his head and decided, okay, we'll take care of this. The next day, Joey went and met with the woodcutters, and as they were about to head off into the forest, a couple of soldiers from the king's guard came riding up. And the captain of the palace guard said, you men, you woodcutters, you are enlisted by the king now to be new guards of the palace. So come with me, and you will be new guards for the palace. Joey was swept up with the other men, taken to the palace. He was given a whole suit of armor. He was given a beautiful sword with a scabbard and a hilt. And he was told now that you and this other woodcutter will guard this door all day long. All you have to do is stand there and guard the door. And Joey had a great day that day as he was guarding the door, and people would pass by and he talked with them, and he explained how he was now a new palace guard, and this was his profession, and what a shiny suit of armor that he had, and a beautiful beautiful sword at his side. And at the end of the day, Johnny went up to the captain of the palace guards and he said, "Sir, can I now have my pay for the day, my wages for the day?" And the captain of the guards said, "Oh, no. Palace guards are only paid once a month. You have to wait another 3 weeks before you'll receive any wages." So he looked at it, shook his head, decided to go on his way. As he was walking back to his cottage, he passed a pawn shop. He looked at the pawn shop, and he looked at what he was wearing. He went into that pawn shop, and he drew his sword, and he said, "How much can you give me for the metal on this sword?" And the man at the pawn shop said, "That's the finest of the king's metal right there. You can pawn that for a princely sum of money." And so Joey said, "Well, remove the metal of the sword and I will pawn it. Would you promise to hold it for 3 weeks?" And the pawn shop man said, "Well, yes, I can do that. I'll hold it for 3 weeks." Johnny said, "I'll be back. I'll be back when I get my wages and I'll purchase it back from you." And so Johnny took the money that he had. He went by and he bought a loaf of bread. He bought a skin of wine. He bought cheese and he bought meat to go for his meal that evening. And he went and he prepared his meal. Before he sat down, once again, a knock came at his door. And it's King Jonathan, dressed as the pauper Johnny. And the king came in. He couldn't believe his eyes when he saw the feast on the table. And Joey explained to him exactly what had happened to him during the day. And said, "I pawned my sword." And he said, "Not only did I pawn my sword, but I decided that I needed to have something in the scabbard. So I've actually carved a wooden sword that I'm going to put in the hilt of the sword itself. And I'll put it in the scabbard and then it'll feel and look like I have a real sword by my side. Palace guard in these good times is never going to need a bold sword. So I'll be fine and then I'll pawn it. That I will get it back in 3 weeks when I get my wages and everything will be fine and I will be the palace guard." King Jonathan left, shaking his head once again. He said, "Well, I have him now. He won't feel so happy and be whistling every night when he spends a couple of weeks in the prison because he has pawned off part of his uniform as a palace guard." So the next morning, Joey goes in and he takes his position in his armor with his wooden sword beside him inside the scabbard. Of course, no one can tell. And he's standing there by the door, guarding the door, talking to his fellow guard and all the people that pass by, when all of a sudden the captain of the guard comes up, and with him he has a prisoner. And he points to Joey, and he says, "You there, come." And Joey came over and he said, "This man is accused of just stealing a loaf of bread. So the king has ordered that you pull your sword and cut off his hand." And the man is going, "No, I didn't steal bread." And all the crowd is going, "He's a good man. He's a good man. Why would he need to steal bread?" And the captain of the guard said, "No, you pull your sword and cut off his hand because he has stole the bread." Joey looks around. He thinks for a minute. He looks up. He puts his hand on the hilt of his sword. He looks up and he says, "God, if this man is guilty, I will do as told. But if this man is innocent, turn my sword into wood." And he pulls the sword. And everyone can see that it's a wooden sword. And all the crowd gasps. And they say, "It's a miracle. It's a miracle." And of course, the man has to be set free. And at that moment, the king, dressed in his kingly garb, walks out of the crowd. And he walks over to Joey. And he says, Joey immediately bows down. The king says, "Joey, stand up." He says, "Joey, do you recognize me? Do you know who I am?" Joey looks at him closely and he sees the worry lines in the king's forehead and next to his eyes. And he said, "Wait, are you Johnny?" And King Jonathan says, "Yes, I am the Johnny that has been eating at your table the last 4 nights. And I tell you, Joey, you have convinced me that day by day, God is good. So it is well. It is well with my soul. So Joey, you are invited to come to my table each and every evening, and you will be one of my closest advisors. And you will always say at the end of the evening, day by day, God is good. It is well. It is well with my soul. And so King Jonathan lived out his reign in peace, in prosperity, and in joy, because he knew that day by day, God is good. So it is well. It is well with my soul. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our hymn of response this morning is 705. If you open it up, you will see that that is, it is well with my soul. And why I had to change it to this instead. We're going to sing the first and the fourth verses of It Is Well With My Soul. So let's rise, either in body or in spirit, and sing together number 705.
Everlasting. Amen.
given by 25 people this past week as they gave of their talents and of their time to share in Vacation Bible School with all the children that were here. So we certainly are very appreciative of that offering. And it is now time for us to continue with our offerings here. We have an offering plate in the back on the table and near the door as you leave. Your tithes and your monetary offerings are important as well, as are the offerings of your own talents to share in any way that you can in the ministries of this church. So we are eternally grateful for all those various types of offerings that are given on behalf of the ministry here at First Presbyterian Church. Listen now to this offertory blessing. Almighty God, we constantly bring before you our offerings, our tithes, our monetary offerings, but also our actions, our deeds, those ways in which we can use our hands and our feet and our talents to minister on your behalf. We ask that you bless them. You bless those talents that were shown forth this week and those that will shine forth in the next several weeks among members of this congregation. And we ask that you bless the monetary offerings that we bring forward this day and other days as well. Use all these offerings in the ministries of your love and grace spread through your people here at First Presbyterian Church. It is in your holy name that we pray. Amen. Let us now prepare our hearts and minds for our pastoral prayer, the Lord's Prayer. Shall we pray? Holy God, we as your people still have many needs. We need sustenance, we need clothing, we need food, we need friendship, companionship, we need love. We need to feel appreciated. We need to feel as if we are capable in our work and valued in our contribution to those around us. You tell us, our God, to share our needs with you. You tell us to ask for the fulfillment of our needs. You ask us to talk to you about the many hungers that we have that so desperately need to be filled. And yet, when we receive the things that we want, we only feel satisfied for a short while. We often fail to even offer thanks to you. We move on to the next thing, the next thing, and the next thing. So our God, this day, help us to come to you first and foremost, seeking to have you, to have your love, and to have a sense of your presence in our lives. We need so many things, but so often we fail to realize that we need you, our God, the most. And this day we ask that you be with those we love, be with those who may be in mourning. We ask that you heal those who are sick. We ask that you bring peace to the nations of the world. And we ask that you inspire us to continue to work as a community of faith and to help us to reach the rest of your community with your gospel and with your love. We ask also that you bless our nation and help us as a people to be a people of love and justice and holiness. Our God, we know that by your dying on the cross for us, you have shown us that you have truly given us your all, that you have given your very self to us. Help us to believe it and to live as if it's true in our lives. Continue to be with us now, God, as together we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is number 450, Lift I the Cross. We're going to sing the first verse only of this hymn. So let us now rise one last time, either in body or in spirit, and sing together the first verse of Lift I the Cross. Shall we? Amen.